But I still continue to, I mean, work in this area, kind of a intersection area between agriculture and machine learning. We are trying to do certain things, developing certain application for the actual users on the ground. That's the whole idea. So you will find me a kind of an application or the papers which are the problems on the ground related to agriculture. So that is one thing. And recently, I developed some certain interest in the domain of environment, particularly carbon sequestration. That's the one area where I have started working. Hopefully, I'll be able to work on that area also. So that's the recent interest in my area. You know?
Okay. Yeah. So yeah, I will definitely reach out to you. So Dushyant, Anmol, when you tell me that you have sufficient number of people, or when you want me to start, I will.
Sure.
I'm supposed to start, or Professor Das Gupta is supposed to provide an introduction, or
So we'll ask Director Sir and Ghosh Sir to have a few words, and then we'll just bring you on, introduce you, and bring you on for the session.
Okay. So there is quite a bit of satellite and environment in my discussion today, because that's the domain I work in.
Oh, that's wonderful. Okay, I think the director is supposed to formally start the process. Are you welcoming?
Yes, sir. We'll call on director, sir. We'll call on director, sir, in a moment. Just as soon as we receive the call from SPC.
Okay.
So, why don't you just let us know when we are good to go?
I think we are good to go now.
Okay, ready? Yeah. All right. Very good evening. Good morning to all of you present here. I hope I am very clearly audible. Hope all of you are doing pretty well in the times of the global pandemic that we are facing here. Unfortunately, this session could not have happened offline, but anyway, we are trying to make the best use of the opportunity that we have here. Thank you all for joining us today. I'm really honored to have Director Sir, Professor K. Gupta, respected Dean Students Go Sir, as well as our alumni from the 2009 BTech ICT batch, Mr. Mayank Mishra, sir. To give you a brief about what the lecture series is, it is an attempt that was initiated by respected director, sir. It was executed under the leadership of course, sir, by the student body government, CSBG, it is a sort of a utilization of the remote world today. Because in the present situation, whatever career opportunities that we are looking for are in a bit of insecurity, be it any domain that we wish to go, be it our plans for further studies in either technology or business, be it MS or MBA. Each of them are burdened with a lot of questions that we have. And we believe that the best person who would be the right one to answer these questions is someone who has gone through the very same journey that we are planning to go through, and that is our alumni. So the present situation has made us wonder if the steps we aim to take would actually pay off, right? So for that reason, we have one of our alumni, Mr. Mayank Mishra, with us here today. For the session, I would request that students who wish to ask any sort of question, you are not given the privilege to unmute yourself, just so that it remains seamless. So you just have to use the raise a hand functionality that is given in WebEx. So we'll unmute you as and when it is possible, right? So you won't be able to unmute yourselves directly, the people who are attendees. So you just have to raise your hand and we'll just unmute you now and then. Kanupriya ma'am, now you're good to go.
Hello Mayank, hello sir, hello everyone who is here to join us today. So I am Kanupriya Das Gupta. I work as a media officer at the institute, like Dushyant mentioned. So today we are kicking our first alumni lecture series, and first of all, I would like to like Director Sir to talk a bit about this because it was his idea to, you know, like, it was an initiative to get started with this. So for Director Sir, if you can, you know, like, tell us few words about this and what do you expect in future and, you know, like, about this initiative in general.
Yes, thank you, Kanupriya, and dear Mayank, and Dean students, Professor Ranindu Ghosh, Dean Academic Program, Professor Sumit Mitra, Dean R&D, Professor Sanjeev Gupta, Registrar, Executive Registrar, Mr. Soman Nair, and also all my faculty members, and SPG team member led by Anmol, Kanupriya, and dear students. Very good morning to all of you. And in fact, I'm excited and I'm delighted too, because a dream which was pending for quite some time is becoming a reality today. And this is a in the right time, we are having this sort of an webinar series where alumni can interact with different alumnus of our institute. Because one thing has happened is that pandemic has created a disruption throughout in our everyday life. But one thing is there, it has given certain good things also, that the good thing is in terms of providing online education or online delivery or webinar as a part of our life. So it has become a new normal, and all of you know that new normal is moving with an abnormal speed, and maybe after some time it will become blended mode, may become the next step of thing, and on campus delivery could be the third option. So at this point, let me first, I don't want to thank Mike, but because he is part of our family, and any family member, we have to appreciate, we have to respect their emotional bonding, their intellectual attachment to our institute. This particular moment, he has volunteered himself to be the first speaker. So really, I respect that, and I'm really, from the heart of heart, I wish that, you know, it becomes a grand success. Now, all of you must be maybe interested in knowing what is the genesis of this process. And the genesis of this process is, you must be knowing Professor Adityanath Sarkar, who is our adjunct faculty, and he is very close to the students. And then he once sent me one email with Mayank, CV, as well as Anirudh Das CV. And fortunately, I was knowing Anirudh Das because I had the privilege of having a mentoring him in one of the small projects when he was visiting a Space Application Center. So we immediately I responded to their mail and said that why can't we have a discussion. Then we had two discussions over a Google Meet, and the discussions besides me, Dean AP, Dean R&D, Dean students, Professor Anish Mathuria, Professor N.V. Joshi, Professor Maniklal Das, and Professor Anjan Ghosh were there. And most interesting for me is the amount of interest Mayank and Anirudh took. They gave a lot of suggestions. They say that we can do this, we can do that. And then we wanted to find out that what sort of attachments or engagements they will have in our elective courses, whether they can deliver certain modules or certain micro credits and so on and so forth. But I was a little anxious because, you know, I am from ISRO. So I thought, you know, how to start the process running. And then I said it has to start from September. Then Mayank said, yes, sir, I will give a lecture. So that is done. So once he said, yes, the rest of the things is you see what is the outcome of it. And then I said, Anirudh has to give one in October. He has also agreed. So actually in calendar, September, October, they are booked. And then we have left with November and December. And when the next semester starts, winter semester starts, we will have a calendar. What I request to all the alumni of our institute, whether they are in India or whether they are abroad, they should put their names and the interest and the type of topic they want to interact with the student, and we will make a calendar, and we'll, and SBG will anchor this, because you know, before this meeting, before this event, I had a meeting with Professor Ranindu Ghosh as well as Anmol and his team. And I told them very clearly that it is an institute commitment, and we have to see that it becomes a success. And I'm sure that, you know, SBG being an elected body and is a connect between the students and faculty and administration, so they will do an excellent job. So this will be, because any leading universities have this sort of a mechanism called webinar, and we should not miss this thing. It creates a different connectivity. You know, all the alumni, they have spent quite a bit of time in the campus. Now they are working in different leading organizations and institute. So they have gone through they had different aspirations when they were in the campus. They had different aspirations when they go abroad or join the organization. And they have faced different challenges. So if all these things are, they have faced, why can't they share this with the students? Because the students need this sort of motivation, this sort of, the real life stories, such that they can emulate, or they can try to see that the life outside is not always rosy. You have to struggle, you have to fight, and you have to win the battle. So this sort of an engagement, I feel, is a win-win situation, both for the institute as well as for the students. And this is really a new, contributions of the alumni in DICT. We have an alumni association, and we are trying to get in touch with them to try to make it a more vibrant system. But at this point in time, I want a more stronger relationship, and we want a robust connectivity, because the thing happens when some of the faculty lifts the telephone or send a mail to one of our alumni and alumnus and say that, can you give a lecture or something like that? Then we know the system works. So I'm very hopeful that it will turn into a big event, and we have a lot of things on our card. I don't want to preempt at this point in time, but one thing I can say that we are serious about it. And one thing I have understood, that the alumni also are interested in providing their best in terms of intellectual competence, in terms of sharing their experiences with the students. And I'm sure the students will enjoy it, and students will, and Mayank and Anirudh also told that they have some plans, which let them say, I don't want to preempt that. So in overall, it is a good effort, and I wish good luck to Mayank, and also the best wishes to Anmol and his team and Kanupriya, that you know they do a good job, and it becomes a event which can be said it's one of the unique event in Gujarat which is being done by DICT. If that message goes, I'm happy, and I will give you more responsibilities, SBG, I can tell you, and you will also enjoy. So thank you very much for giving me this opportunity. I should not hog the time, and now Mayank has to run do the rest of the thing. I pass over to Kanupriya or SBG to go for the next event. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. It feels rather motivating to realize your foresight, and you know, which can actually help us beyond our journey at DICT. So right now, I'll hand over the mic to Professor Ghosh. He's the Dean of Students, and he's actually the faculty force behind SBG, and for not just this program, but anything that is happening at SBG. So his interest in climate does make him a rather, you know, like, analyst in today's talk. So Professor Ghosh, if you could, tell us something about this, and what do you expect?
Thank you, Kanupriya. Thank you very much. I must at the outset thank not only Mayank and Anirudh as director said, but I would really, really compliment our director for initiating this activity. That's very important, you know. And he has not only initiated; it is his brainchild. We had a series of discussion, as he has already mentioned, within our faculty, and then today we are here. And I would profusely thank Mayank and Anirudh to agreeing for this be a first speaker. So, you know, it is not always easy to become the opening batsman when the ball shines very much, you know. So it runs at a very high speed. So it requires courage to open the innings. And I thank Mayank and Anirudh, both of them, to become the first speaker. I also take the opportunity to the SBG members, including Dushyant and Kanupriya, for steering the program. It's a very unique thing probably is happening that the SBG is steering the whole thing. And director is very keen to put SBG as the front end of this lecture series. So that's one good part of it, because it is the SBG or the students community who will be connecting with their alumnus who are already settled in their life. So, and I'm sure all of our students are looking for certain kind of a role model in their life. And people like Mayank, Anirudh would be different role model for different students in that domain area. So I'm looking for a success for this this event. And as director has already mentioned that we have already decided for another speaker, and maybe in another 10-15 days we'll be deciding for the remaining two speakers this semester. And then in the next semester, depending upon the circumstances, how it moves, probably we are thinking in a slightly bigger way, how to engage this faculty, how to engage this alumnus with the academic environment in the institute, because they have a lot to offer. I'm sure they have a lot to offer, because they have seen the world, they have seen the competition, they have seen the, how the world grows and which way world will be moving. Probably being only at JICT, at least I am not very clear about it, but I am looking for some engagement with Mayank and people like them to show the students at JICT that this is the way, this is the way you should move, and this is how you should try to engage yourself. And that's the, I think it's very important for our students' community. In fact, this kind of an engagement is very, very much there in institutes like IIT and IIM. And it was not very prominent in our institute, but hopefully this engagement will slowly snowball into bigger event. And I'm sure that the alumnus will be contributing a lot for the students' community as well as for the institute. And I'm looking for the SBG to ensure become a catalyst in the whole process. So thank you, Mayank, once again. And thank you all my colleagues at JICT, dear students. And please try to see how best we can take advantage of this scenario. Please ensure that you continue to interact with Mayank and the students like them or the alumni like them for your kind of a future kind of a engagement. Thank you once again, and I hope all the success for this event. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. We would always look forward for your support. So now we finally move on to the much awaited talk by Mr. Mayank Mishra. So a bit of background about him is that he is a 2009 batch graduate in ICT from DIICT, and his accolades are close to surreal, with an MS in Business Analytics from the US of Cincinnati and an MBA from Columbia Business School. So this distinguished degrees are quite an affair for Mayank, and also we'd ask him to start the talk, and we'd go ahead with the same.
Hey everyone, before I get into anything, just I want the administrators to know that I do not have my screen sharing ability switched on. So if you guys can look into it while I
talk. They are doing it. Yeah.
Okay. So now it's enabled. Thanks. Okay. So let me then just jump ahead and start telling you about what I want to talk. So I'm hoping that I have about 40 minutes till 12 noon to talk about, and I'll be covering few things. First thing is I'll just give a brief background about myself in terms of why I am where I am and how I reached where I am. And then the second part is about the core topic of today's discussion is the multidisciplinary of today's workforce. So that is some talk about, and then I'll, based on what I do, I'll give you an example of how that is quite relevant to my work and the work associated with the people who work in similar domains as I do. And then after that, I will talk about how you might want to prepare yourself for working in such multidisciplinary domains. And then lastly, I would just throw it to questions, or if you want, I can also talk about just in general, if you have any points that you want me to address. So let me start with.
Yeah, so, you know, I would start with like the first question, like, you know, if you could just tell us something about your journey in terms of personal as well as professional decisions and milestones. And then if you can just move on to, you know, how like DISIT helped on your journey so far and your memories and lessons from the institute of 4 years of life spent here.
Yeah, so I'm originally from a part of Bihar. From close to a district called Madhubani, so that's where my parents are from. And then I have lived in multiple cities growing up, and then I ended up joining Dhirubhai my undergrad, and that was easily one of the best decisions, primarily because the school is structured very differently from a lot of other universities in India. So you get a lot of chance to explore topics outside of the core technical. And that is something that is very difficult to focus on if you have not start building that up in early, learning phase. So when you are in undergrad, that is one of the times when your ability to learn is at, I shouldn't say the peak, but it's very close to the peak. And that is where you are able to absorb a lot of information. And that helps a lot if you are looking for a career in a multidisciplinary domain, because when you are hoping to learn a lot of topics from a wide variety of, it is not about the topics itself or the fields, but ability to learn it and to learn it on the fly and to learn it in a manner where you're able to also implement it, apply it. So that is one of the most important things that I learned at Dhirubhai Mani, was that outside of the courses, there were a lot of courses in humanities, a lot of courses in just the social sciences, which are actually extremely important for your career if you are hoping to work in a broader domains. And before I get too deep into about myself, I should just also bring up the point that all of this started because of the not so how I should term it. It's a sad affair that Professor Asim Banerjee passed away, and that is when my college roommate, he contacted me, informed me about that, and then there was a service for him online, and we joined it. And then one of our professors, who's, I think I took every elective of his, Professor Adityanath Sarkar, he called me and called both of us, Anirudh and me, and asked us that, why don't we do something for the college? Why don't you get back and do something for the college? So because it was Professor Sarkar, we said, okay, we'll look into it. And Professor Asim Banerjee, just a few words about him. We have very fond memories of him. So you learn a little bit of programming, at least that back in those days. So I joined school in 2005. You learn a bit of programming in your high school days, but you don't necessarily build your foundations properly until your undergrad. And that is where a lot of our foundations were built in his courses. And he was quite approachable, and he was actually supposed to be my first mentor for my final year project. But thanks to some of the things that I did not do properly, it did not go that well. And then he was nice enough to redirect me to a topic that would be of a better interest to me, which actually is the exact domain that I've been working since my final year project, which is in the field of probability and statistics. So going back to my background from the probability and statistics, you learn a lot of fields, a lot of topics in your undergrad, but then there are some things that stay with you and some things that you find that you would be able to apply more. And in my case, I graduated in 2009, which was similar to today, not one of the best times to graduate. So the market is not what you expected when you entered undergrad and when you are graduating. If you have some kind of a financial crisis or an economic slowdown, you have to have a very different mindset when you're entering that market. And one of the important part of that mindset is you need to be very open in terms of what you are willing to sign up for. So if you restrict yourself that, no, this is exactly what I want to do and this is the only thing I'll do, you will be able to do it, but that will be a much harder journey for you. A lot of the students, what they do is, particularly in India, is people often move to graduate degrees, and that is one of the options when you are graduating or when you are in a economic slowdown. Almost globally, people go back to school because the jobs are not the best ones out there, and people try to wait it out in the graduate school. So that is a very good option for a lot of the students in these times. Is you should look, if you're not finding the job of your interest, you should not push yourself for anything, but see if you can enter graduate school and then spend your 2 years there, and then hopefully by the time things would improve and then you can come out. The other option is the one that I took, which was I decided to take up whatever I get in the fields that interest me. So I tried a little bit of programming jobs. I did not necessarily like them, and then I decided to use my statistical background and I entered in the domain which is related to insurance and risk management. And within that, I worked for a firm which is in Bangalore, and just to give you an overview of the industry that I'm in. So I should switch to, can you guys, if anyone of you can tell me if you can see my screen?
Yeah, we can.
Okay. So I'll give you a brief overview of the industry that I am in. And the industry that I am in is part of this wider insurance markets domain. So the fundamental concept of insurance is the fact that you pay someone a small fee to take an unprecedented risk on your behalf. Life insurance, you pay someone a premium, and in return, they give you a lump sum amount when something happens to you. Same thing with house, home insurance. So that's and the insurance can be bought by a company. Company wants to insure its assets against, let's say, all kinds of events like fire or bigger events such as an earthquake and all. And same is true for governments. Then you have primary insurers like people like you. You buy car insurance, bike insurance, home insurance, and then even the insurance companies, once they sell a lot of these insurance policies, they accumulate a lot of risk on their books. So how do I put it in a simple manner is, think of it that you are paying a very small percentage of the risk that is being covered upfront. So you will pay 10% or 5% or 3% of the coverage that you are getting for buying an insurance. So and the point of that is, if I am an insurance company, I am selling that policy to 1 lakh people, but I believe only 20 of them come to me asking for claims. So if I collect a small amount for 1 lakh people, that should be sufficient to pay these 20 people. But then what may happen is that there could be scenarios where half of those 50,000 people might show up asking for claims in events such as earthquakes, hurricanes, which if domain. Okay. So in that case, those insurance companies need to buy insurance for themselves, which is reinsurance. So I started working somewhere between these two, where I was working for a reinsurance brokerage firm, where we were helping insurance companies buy insurance from themselves from reinsurance companies. And And how that happens is, think of it as, people often say that don't put all of your eggs in one basket. So, and the point of that is you have to diversify your risk so that if you have some loss in one basket, you still have stuff in other baskets that you can live off. So similarly, insurance companies, they don't write all of the houses on the same street. Their basket is street. Don't put all of your policies on one street, because if one house catches fire, all can catch fire. And for reinsurance companies, the bigger, it's kind of a country, that don't write all of your insurance companies in one country. You write some insurance companies in one country, another insurance company in another country, third country, fourth country, so that if there's a big event in one country, you still can pay that off from the money that you're earning from other countries. So their basket is bigger. And then from reinsurance company, I moved to what is known as insurance linked securities, which is part of the broader capital markets. It is part of what is known as an alternative asset strategies, traditional ones which are equity markets or the bond markets or the interest rate forex. This is kind of a categorized as an asset class. People are diversifying their risk across different asset classes. So for an insurance company, the basket was a street. For an insurance company, the basket was a country. ILS markets, the baskets are different asset classes. So you put some of your money in equity, and if the stock markets do well, you get money out of it. And then you put some money in bond market, you put some money in hedge fund, you put some money in insurance linked securities, so that if one of them fails or if two of them fails, you still have money to get from other markets. For example, we had this big stock market meltdown in earlier this year in March, starting mid of March towards end of March. And because we work with risk that is related to earthquakes, hurricanes, and such kind of weather and climate events, our portfolio was not affected because it has nothing to do with the markets or nothing to do with economy. It has to do with events such as these wider, bigger climate or weather related or geological events. So people who invested with us, they had money that was very well safe in our portfolios, because while their equity markets shrank by about their equity portfolio shrank by 30% or so. So that's my journey, starting from the reinsurance brokerage to reinsurance market to ILS. And while doing so, I started working in India, but there were not a lot of, the insurance market in India is still in its very infant stage. So I did not see that I have, so after working for 2 years there, I realized that I need to find something else to keep me interested and for my career growth. So I applied almost, 50, 60 countries. And I ended up in Middle East. And how I would do that is I would just apply to one set of companies in one country 1 week, and then another country another week, and ended up reaching Middle East in a reinsurance company that was part of the Lloyd's London market. So London market has one of the biggest insurance centers, and they open offices in Middle East because of tax reasons and all. So I was there for a couple of years, and then I worked there for a while, but I still wanted to do more advanced work in this domain and still wanted to have a more challenging work role. So, and one of the things that I have realized is you may have a lot of research work going in a lot of places, but there is quite an amount of applied work that happens in US. And that's where I then end up going to US. I needed to know a little bit more about the statistics that I was learning, that I was using in work. So I did a master's, and then after that, I joined Berkshire Reinsurance's subsidiary, where I was again using all of these statistical tools to price the risk. And what that means is, we'll get into that, but what that fundamentally means is understanding the expected value or the average. So what, on an average, how much do you expect to lose money in 1 year? So that was my job for different lines of business. And then finally, I did a lot of, I was there for 3 years, and then I started again wondering, okay, what is the next that I can do with what I already know? So I realized that, okay, my two options were either I continue doing that or I go back to school and learn a little bit more. And this kind of back and forth between school and the corporate life or work life helped me particularly, because what happens is particularly in today's domain, and now I'm referencing the topic of the multidisciplinary nature, you start with your foundation in one field, and then that foundation gets you working, but then you very quickly realize that you will need to learn a lot more, and you learn a lot more at your job, but then what you learn at your job is not always it doesn't always build your foundation. It tells you how to get the job done, but you are not very confident about it for quite a bit of time. And I had a big issue with this, because I knew what I was doing, but I didn't necessarily know quite a large part of it. And one of the big aspects that I had issues with was assumptions. So when you are in school, you study from foundations and you are taught theory of it. And a big part of the theory is understanding the assumptions of it. So you're taught all kinds of algorithms, you're taught all kinds of models, all kinds of statistics. And one of the things that is extremely important that we generally do not focus particularly in school, even though it's taught quite a bit, is assumptions. That is, under what scenarios is what is being taught applicable, and how much can you diverge from the theoretical in actual application? You can diverge a little bit, but then if you start diverging a lot, you can start reaching a point where what you are applying is no longer applicable to where you are applying it. And that is extremely important. And that is something that you get to learn primarily only through either school or doing an online course or doing some kind of a course. But on the job, learning about the broader aspect of the foundation is difficult. And that's when I went back to, so I learned a lot of the business and finance while working, but then I always had this issue that I'm not confident with accounting, or I'm not confident with corporate finance or capital markets. So that's when I went back to school. Okay, I need to learn a lot of that to be able to be confidently communicate with people about those things. So that is something that you should also note, is that you will have to learn a lot. The question is how you figure out what is the most efficient way for you to learn, so that you can say that you actually know it, or know it to a certain extent. In today's complex world, there's no one who knows everything about any single topic. But then the question is, do you know beginner level or intermediate level or advanced level? And as a generalist, what you would be expected to know is, which is evolving with time, is earlier you could say that I know a lot about this one field, and then I know very little about these five fields. That is no longer the case with generalist also. Particularly if you go to business schools now, you will find that people who are of that kind of a background, they struggle quite a bit, because a single field specialization in a generalist field doesn't help. You have to actually be a proper specialist, which is someone like Anirudh, who's going to take the next talk. He's specialist in one field. So you have to actually know to a very advanced level as to what you're doing. But if you want to be working in a generalist domain, you have to have a good solid foundation in one or two fields, but you need to know at least intermediate level in multiple fields. And what is driving that is there is more and more work being done by fewer and fewer people. And that is the trend that has happened over past 200, 300 years. People were working in agricultural domain. There were a lot of people working on farms. Then moved to manufacturing industry, and there were fewer people, but there were still a lot of people involved in manufacturing. And then today's major economies, and definitely a big part of, again, let's say the graduate workforce works in service economy. And one of the primary differentiating features of a service economy is that if you are smart and if you know what you're doing, you can do work of a lot of people yourself. And that constrains the amount of the kind of jobs you would like to do, or the number of jobs that are available. So you need to be really good at not just one, but multiple set of fields to be able to get the kind of jobs or the kind of career opportunity that you are seeking if you are hoping to work in a generalized domain. And that is one of the things that, if you remember anything from this talk, that is one thing you should definitely remember, is if you do not like studying one topic for quite a bit of time, and if you are more of a generalist mindset, then you still have to have some portion of a specialist mindset in you, because you have to approach at least the intermediate level in several fields. So the field that I work in, particularly in the ILS domain, as I mentioned, the fundamental risk that we deal with is climate and weather. So, and in that, what happens is we are working with financial products. So we are working with all kinds of banks, all kinds of different kinds of asset managers. We are working with different kinds of companies who need help with financial management. And in that, for us, they come to us and we take on their risk for weather and climate. What that means is we essentially absorb any shock that they might see from these events. So I am now going to get a little bit technical, not too much, but a little bit. So what you see here is a graph which, on the x-axis, you have the loss in billions of dollars. And on the y-axis, you have the probability of exceedance of that loss. So this is you might recognize this. This is 1/e to the power x. So it's inverted exponential. And so here, let's say it's a 20 billion loss. So the probability of exceedance of a 20 billion loss is 5%. What that means is, for this particular book that you are looking at, they expect to lose 5%, or they expect their probability of losing a $20 billion loss is 5% or less. So, and on the other tail end, the 80 billion is less than about, I think, 1%. So the companies that we work with who want us to absorb their shock, and they tell us, okay, I am willing to withhold all the risk. I am willing to bear the risk up to 20 billion, but please help us with the risk from 20 billion to 40 billion. So we will say, okay, we will cover all of your losses that happen once you have a loss in excess of 20 billion up to 40 billion, for which we will charge them a certain fee. And that fee, if you remove all the profit loading and all those things, that fee essentially is the area under this curve. So if you shade this area, and if you are saying that we will take your risk on this, this the area under this curve is the fee that we are going to charge to take the risk of all the loss that may happen to them, which is in excess of 20 billion up to 40 billion. So that starts a probability about 3% to 6%. So, and this involves coming up with distribution. Part of my job, that how do I come up with distribution? And then the second part of my job is computing these probabilities, and then computing the fee that we have to charge. And that involves a lot of stats and a lot of calculus and all those things. So that is close to about 1/3 or 1/4 of my job is doing that. So that's and that is the foundation that I started working in the industry, that I thought, okay, I know stats, I know a bit of calculus, so I can do this kind of a technical work. But then what is this distribution, or how are they having this loss? So the loss that we cover them for are for, as I've been mentioning, extreme weather and climate events. So give you an example, I will move to the second tab, which is, you're looking at the US map, and we deal with primarily US risk, but we cover for all these climate and weather events globally. So I'm going to show you a kind of a damage that can cause that of a loss. So I'm zooming into a state of Florida, and they had a pretty strong hurricane. And this is a satellite imagery for it. And we are focusing into a certain area called Mexico Beach. And I'm going to remove all these. Sorry, I don't have slides for today because I was in travel, but hopefully this helps you understand what I am trying to convey. So from the topic of finance and business to the topic of and from the topic of calculus and stats to the topic of climate, and a lot of our work is coming up with those distributions and understanding the laws. So you see, you have a lot of these houses here in this area, in Mexico Beach area. These are, some are apartment complexes, some are independent houses, some are commercial setups, some are apartment complexes. And this is the place before the hurricane hit. And now I'm going to overlay what happened after the hurricane hit. Absolute devastation. The houses were completely wiped out. The houses were actually moved away from their foundation, and they were just thrown away in these channels of water, or they went further up north. And that is the kind of destruction that causes damages that enters into billions of dollars. And not just there, but it happened throughout this territory where the hurricane hit. And these are extreme weather events for which you can try building strong houses or houses up to a certain building code, but when something like these hurricanes hit, this was ended up being a Cat 5 hurricane, Hurricane Michael. These can be very devastating. And one of my job is to, once an event happens, I have to work with my team, and we are a small team. We are a team of 3 people. We have to estimate the losses that may have happened here. So we do a lot of satellite based work. Is we look at these before and after imagery, and we are now working on algorithms to improve. So more and more, the satellite imagery is becoming cheaper and readily accessible, and also accessible in a timely manner. Earlier, it used to take, you used to have to wait for the satellites to make a trip, or you would have to call up a satellite company and tell them that you want satellite imagery for this, and then they would turn their satellite cameras to the area of your interest, and they'll charge you a fee for it. But now there are so many satellites that you will get pretty decent imagery, and also at a very economical cost. It's not that you have to pay millions for these kind of images now. And this actually is a freely available imagery that is from the US government's website. You know. So you saw the destruction, and what caused this destruction was, now again, I'm going to a map. And as you see, a lot of what I'm going to talk and show is map-based, because when you're working with climate and weather, that is your foundation. So the one foundation is computer science and statistics, but the other foundation is GIS, or just the working with this spatial information. So all your queries or your analysis, they happen at a spatial level. So I'm at the date when that hurricane hits, October 10, around 10, and I'll show you the imagery. So I'm going to zoom in. This is that hurricane. So I'm just scrolling on a 12-hour back schedule. So I'm at 9th October, this AM trip for this satellite. And then you can very clearly see that the eye is now big enough that there is a very distinct eye. So this is a hurricane, and these are quite big. Just to give you an example, how big, if you measure from this side to this side, these can be close to 500 miles is 800 kilometers. So these can be easily 1,000 kilometers in diameter. So they have a big range in terms of the area they can impact, but the biggest wind speeds are around the eye, and as you go further, you will see that the eye becomes more and more prominent, which means that the wind speeds is increasing more and more, and the at which it entered the land, which is known as landfall, the wind speeds were in excess of 250 kilometers per hour. Now, I don't know how fast have you ever driven outside of the plane, but 250 kilometers per hour is extremely, extremely high speed wind. And the problem with that is it starts taking off trees and woods and glasses and starts throwing them at that speed at other things, and that is what causes a lot of destruction. So this is the Hurricane Michael that caused that just removed all of the houses that were in that town of it. And this is one hurricane at one time of the year, but then there are times of the year when you have multiple of these coming through. So this is September 8, 2017. We had three hurricanes back to back that were lined up to hit US. And our job is to monitor these and then figure out once these start making landfall as to, okay, what is the loss that we are hoping to, we are expecting to have. And why that is important, again, a little bit going back to the financial aspect of it, is because let's say you believe that that this event is going to cause a $10 billion loss. And some other party believes that it's going to be a $5 billion loss. So there is a difference in people's expected value of the financial instruments that underlie this loss. Someone who believes it's going to be not a loss, he's going to buy a lot of that bond or derivatives. He will say, okay, I think that the market is mispricing it, that it's not as bad a loss as people think it is. And the people who think it's going to be a very bad loss, they will be willing to sell it at a cheap value. Think of it as if you are familiar with the stock market, if someone says that currently the stock market is the value of the stock is 1,000 rupees, and that is your view, and someone's view is no, it's not 1,000, it's 300 only. So he'll be more than happy to sell you that stock for any value greater than 300 rupees. He'll say, okay, I'm happy to sell you at 301. And because you believe it's 1,000 rupees, you'll be more than happy to buy it at any value between that is less than 1,000 rupees, because you'll still make a profit. So that's what we do, that we have to estimate the industry loss and then communicate it to the fund managers or traders. And based on the inputs from us, they will talk to the market and figure out, okay, are there mispricings in the market? And that's why we have to do all kinds of analysis to be sure that what we are doing is at least as close to truth as possible. So we don't necessarily have to be we don't necessarily have to come up with the exact number. We just have to be better than everyone else in the market. So if everyone else is off by 50%, even if you are off by 45%, we'll still make profit out of it, because there will be mispricings if we are correct. So, and this is the scenario as of today. So you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 of them currently in the Atlantic. So I'll just overlay map and I will remove these tracks. And you can see there is one that is churning here. There's one that is churning here. And a lot of these hurricanes start in Africa, in offshore Africa. There is this particular region. This is the region where most of the cyclones originate that hit North America. And why I'm just focusing on North America is because that's the area I'm most familiar with in terms of these kind of analysis. I will skip this tab. And then, so we have a lot of information that is publicly available, that research that is being done by countries, that is being done by all kinds of organizations throughout the world. And one of the biggest resources that we have is these big numerical weather prediction models. And these models are run by on massive supercomputers, and they keep churning all the data that they collect on, some collect on a 3-hourly basis, some collect on a 6-hourly basis, and they process that information to come up with what is the likelihood of the climate and weather scenario n times from now. So this is, we are looking at a model that is built by the US government, which is called the GEFS model. And the GEFS model, it's running, these are the different run times. So it's running at 12 hours different. So 18Z, 12Z, 6Z, 0Z, 18Z, 12Z. And at every 6 hours, it comes up with a projection 16 days ahead. So this is the current status. So this is the current status. It's seeing that there is something that is coming up here, something that is coming up here. And then if I go, let's say 120 hours from now, you can see that this has grown up to here, this has grown up to here. So this is the future projection. This is a grown up to here. There's something here. And why do you have so many wiggly lines? It's because these are different simulations. So the thing with working with a lot of these models, and whether you are working in business domain or in technical domain, a lot of the data analysis that happens to understand something that may happen in future. There are a lot of work that is done to understand the past as well, but that is to inform your future choices, future decisions. And a big component of coming up with that is through simulations. I know you have a course in simulations, but that is a big part of what we do, is we work with a lot of these simulations. And here you see this model has come up with 20 different simulations of the same event, knowing that it is today here and knowing all of its characteristic. These are the 50 possibilities of what it might look 120 hours from now. Okay, so similarly for this one, these are the n number of possibilities, and this are n number of possibilities. So we get quite a bit of lead time in understanding these hurricanes. Now, the question is, how good are these forecasts? So that differs from event to event. For some events, these are absolutely bang on, that is what the models projected actually happens. But then there are times when the models fail in even correctly predicting 6 hours ahead. And that is because climate is an extremely, the weather and the atmosphere and all the atmospheric phenomena, they're extremely complicated. There are hundreds and thousands of variables that you have to take into account, and models try to do as best as they can, but it's still an evolving phase. 10 years back, the models were doing a lot worse. Today, they are doing a lot better, but it's a continuous journey. And if you are interested, the other thing that happens is, so we talked about the finance aspect of things, we talked about the statistical aspect of things, we talked about the climate aspect of things, and I'll just give you a brief overview that we also have to understand the physics aspect of things. Because when these events happen, we are constantly on phone with professors and researchers and people who work in this domain to understand what this event might look like when it actually makes a landfall. Because we need to estimate, we need to provide those numbers to the fund managers or our investors, because people who have given us money to invest in these things, they see these things on the news and they will call us up and ask. Even if it has nothing to do with it, they would want us to understand what this event is and how it's doing, and they would expect us to know every bit of detail about it, to the extent that obviously we can explain it to them. There are times when we tell them, okay, want to know more than this, then we will have to get an expert on the call. This is to the point that I can explain it to you. So what is a hurricane? Essentially, it's a thermodynamic engine. So there's a lot of physics involved, and you will have to, if you work in this domain, you will have to brush up on your thermodynamics a lot. So what it does is it takes the heat content from the oceans and transfers it to the upper layers of the atmosphere. That is the primary reason hurricanes happen, or what is known as tropical cyclone in India or typhoon in Japan, is they are heat transfer mechanism. They draw in the sea water, evaporates, becomes water vapor, and in doing so, it captures the latent heat. So it absorbs the heat from the sea as latent heat, and it becomes clouds, and it moves up, radiates up to the top, goes far out. As I was showing, it could be 1,000 kilometers wide. It goes far out and keeps moving up north and north. And then it does, the water vapor becomes cloud and it rains. And as it rains, it starts releasing that latent heat, because now it's becoming water droplets. So that is essentially the heat mechanism. And this is a cycle that continues as long as it's on the water. And once it moves to the land, it no longer has the heat from the sea. So this entire system eventually collapses. So that's the hurricane. So there is quite a bit involved, and you have to read a lot of papers. We have to sit with professors and researchers, and we cannot use their time to start with very fundamental basics. So we try to learn as much as we can before we talk to them. And one of the reason why we talk to them also is to also fine tune our models. So our internal models that we prepare for these, we have to fine tune them to better demonstrate what we are wanting to do. And then this is a brief overview of just the tropical cyclone tracks between 2004 and 2014, a 10 year. So you see, you have a lot of these events. There's none here, there's none here, there's only one here. And you can look up why this brings a lot of the ocean currents that you have read back in school. Ocean currents are a big reason why there are no hurricanes here and here, because and why there are more here and in Japan and India and all those places. So that is hurricanes. Similarly, we work with earthquakes. We have to understand a lot of earthquake work. And we recently worked with a couple of researchers who do quite a bit of work in it. So why does an earthquake happen? We all know because the plates move, but what is about the plates moving that causes an earthquake? Take, for example, this is the Indian subcontinent plate, and this plate is moving up north at the speed of about 4 to 5 centimeters per year. And it's a constant movement. But then why do you get earthquakes only now and then? Similarly, this African plate is moving up north at 2 centimeters per year. And you have this Mediterranean ocean here. About, I think, 20 million years from now or 10 million years from now, this ocean would no longer be existing because the African plate would have moved into Europe. So this ocean would have disappeared. And so earthquakes are a portfolio. About 20 to 30% of our money is invested in earthquake risks. So we have to definitely understand a lot of them. And then one of the recent news phenomena that you would be hearing is the wildfires. So we do a lot of work with wildfires, and this, what you're looking in, on your screen, is just the wildfires in last 1 week. So these are the current wildfires that are burning across California, Oregon, Portland, the west coast of United States. So these have become quite frequent events. These were not that, not that big in terms of the cost that they do both to property as well as to people, but recently they have become quite a big thing. And one of the things that to understand with climate and weather, particularly in our domain, is it's not the climate and weather by itself. It's about how it interacts with the wider population. So think of it as, this is one of the fires that I'm now focusing on. This happened in 2018, and campfire, and the amount of damage I'm logged out. So this is what it did. This just completely destroyed, similar to the hurricane. The entire town was burned to the ashes. Every single house was gone. And it has a big impact to life also. With hurricane, what happens is you at least get some lead time, that you have a 5-day warning, 4-day warning. But with wildfires and earthquakes, there is no lead time. You are sleeping, or you are just doing, you're working. And what happens is these happen almost instantaneously. And you don't get a lot of time to plan for it. So some of these can get pretty bad. So these, I gave you example of three of the risks that we work with in the broader scope of our job. So I started with talking about myself, then I talked about the domain that I work in, and then I talked about the financial products that we work with, which help companies absorb their shock, and they pay a fee for it. And then, but the risk, and then there's a part of understanding the risk. So it involves a lot of these fields of business and finance and statistics, and everything that we do is obviously based on computer programming. So whatever I do, it's based off of, I'm using some Python or MATLAB or SQL or all these models, and these are all programming tools. So everything you do is obviously based on programming, but then domain in which it's applied, it could be finance, it could be statistics, it could be just satellite imagery, understanding the before and after. So that is the multidisciplinary nature that I work in, and it's not just my job, but there are more and more of jobs that require you to work in these domains. So even from my perspective, our fund manager, our CEO, they spend 50% of their time coding. So they are, it's not just that now that they have become the CEO and they have been doing that for 20 years, that they no longer will code or they no longer will attend classes. They attend the same classes that we go. So you have to learn constantly for as long as you can. And that is something that people normally do not tell us. That, okay, once you finish your school, you don't have to study much. But then you reach undergrad and they tell you, okay, once you do your undergrad, that's pretty much it. But then that is one thing that you have to realize is that in today's highly complex world and where thanks to the nature or unfortunate nature of the service industry, if you are good at it, you'll be able to do a lot of work by yourself, and that would show up in your career progression and your job satisfaction. But that would require you to learn constantly. Stuff that we do, most of it wasn't available to us, at least on an economical level, back in 2009 when I started. But every year I see that things are becoming cheaper and cheaper, and analysis is becoming cheaper, because we did not have these AWS cloud and all those 5 years back, 6 years back, to be used at the scale that we are using it now. But then that required us to then go and attend classes on those and learn more about those as to how we can use it. And just most recent addition is now AWS is providing satellite as a service. So you can just lease out their infrastructure to use this satellite data. So again, that involves understanding a lot of these phenomena and related tasks. So this brings, we are at 12:10, but I'll just speak 3 more minutes about how do you...
I would like to ask you a question.
Yes.
Discussing regarding the natural spectrum. So coming up to the capitalist area, and what are the job scopes for those, you know, who are planning to get into risk management solutions, and, you know, which are the companies which are dealing in these areas in India, if, like, if one is planning to get into this, and... India has so many natural disasters all along the year. So what do you have to say on that?
So a lot of the work that happens for the risk in India is actually still being managed by the government. It's currently being given out to private companies per se. So you have options, you have multiple fields. Either you can get into the research domain of it. So you get into the satellite research and that... Professor Das Gupta and Professor Ghosh are more than competent to direct you for that. That if you are interested in climate and weather and satellites, if you are interested in the business aspect of it, there are still not a lot of firms, but I can provide you the list of these. These firms actually are not working for the risks in India. They set up offices because the work gets moved to India where a lot of the analysis happens, and then it gets distributed globally. And that is one of the companies that I started with. It's called Aon, A-O-N. But and more companies are now, as across the board in all industries, they're opening offices in India. But so that is the domain. And in terms of if you're hoping to work with the Indian aspect of risk in this domain, you will have to reach out to someone who works for the disaster management funds. And these are mostly the government entities that work in this domain.
Me the list of the companies. I mean, I would be writing them down. How about that?
Oh, you want me to give you the list now? Okay. So I'll.
I mean, later after this.
Okay. Okay.
Like completed, you know.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay. So secondly, what I wanted to ask was, you know, like going from ICT to finance, it's quite challenging, right? For the non-techies. So do you feel your ICT background gives you like an edge in this? And, you know, how would you compare this edge you had at your time as opposed to today, wherein, you know, like data analytics is close to being a curriculum subject in commerce and like graduation course?
Okay, so the one thing to understand about it, particularly finance, is that, or most domains, is that what people call as analytics, that's becoming the foundation in any industry that you go, be it finance, be it technology, be it any domain. More and more, if you are hoping to work in the core domain of it, you will be working with a lot of data. You will be working with a lot of analytics. It could be that someone else is doing it for you, but then you will still be required to be an informed user of it. Or what will happen is you will have 5 PhDs sitting in front of you who would be telling you something. And after 5 seconds, you will have very little understanding of what they're trying to say. So, and that at that point, it will start affecting your career very quickly. That you may not necessarily need to have that kind of a background, but then you need to have an understanding. And why I bring that up is because of your question as to if you're moving to finance, even in finance, you need to have that kind of a technical background to be able to appreciate these financial products and the underlying risk. And either you get them upfront. So for example, for me, I had that technical background upfront. And on the later stage, I learned it on the job, and then I went to school to learn it more. Or you from a finance background, and then you end up taking courses, or you end up learning programming yourself. And that is something that happens quite a bit, at least in US, is people come from philosophy courses, art majors, and drama theaters, and then they start working in these domains, and then they learn on the job, and then they go back to school, they take more courses, and they come to at par very quickly. So you should not get, let's say, intimidated by the fact that you don't know it. The question is, how quickly are you willing to start learning it? And then how open are you to learning it once you start learning it? Because at times people start these courses, but they often drop off, or they don't have the let's say, the discipline to finish the courses. So that is something that gradually, after a few courses, you start building that, okay. And that is one thing you should start preparing yourself also for, that I don't like it, but I need it, and therefore I must finish it.
Perfect. I guess we have a couple of professors. We have a couple of professors who would be asking, who have, I guess, some doubts. We have Professor Suman Mitra and Professor Sanjay Gupta. So they want you if you can unmute them one by one.
Okay, hello Mayank. This is Suman Mitra.
Can you hear me? Yeah, I can hear you.
Oh, thank you. So it's a nice talk from Ukraine. It reminds me a lot of my life subject, which is statistics. So I would like to know clarify one thing from your end, that there is a science which is very close to statistics and probability. That is actuarial science.
Yes.
And we have an association in India also of actuarial science. So how the actuarial science actually plays role in this kind of a job? Is there any scope of actuarial science or no scope?
So the question is very appropriate. Earlier in the insurance industry and risk management industry, the entire technical task was done by the people with actuarial background. So these are 10 to 15 papers that you have to pass, which are in the domain of statistics. And once you complete, you are essentially qualified to be an actuary. Think of it as a certification. So you once you have 15 exams, you become that. And that is, these are the people who are getting the risk and insurance industries till about 5, 7, 10 years back. And even today, if you have to sign off on it, you need to have a degree on that. But more what's happening is the actuarial are shrinking, and they are being replaced by a lot of the people with pure statistics background, or what I would call computer science and statistics mix. And the reason for that is actuarial science primarily used to depend on curves or distributions that were derived back in the 50s, 70s. And that particular case, people do not at all work with, people rarely work with predefined distributions anymore. They data, the currently available data, and they create distributions out of as recent data as they can. And therefore, your reliance on pure historical or actuarial curves has eliminated in almost a lot of fields in this field. So give you an example. One of the companies, if you look up Prudential, it's one of the biggest companies. They used to have a massive actuarial science. One or two actuaries in one of the biggest offices in US, and rest everyone is kind of the computer science stats background.
thank you, Mayank, for your clarification. Thanks a lot.
We have one more question from Professor Sanjeev Gupta.
Hello, Mayank. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay, it was very nice talk and I really enjoyed it. I'm asking some questions from a student point of view rather than as a professor or a faculty. One question which as a fourth year student of DISCT, what type of job should I look for as a generalist, what you claim yourself, or as a specialist, what Anirudh and others are doing in the today's scenario, which is more acceptable?
I think, okay, so I can start again. The what kind of a job that you should take, I think you should not, I would not suggest people deciding on that in at least first 5 years of their career. So what I would suggest people is go out and try a few things. So what I call as the exploratory stage. So you have to explore the options that are available, because there are all kinds of jobs with all kinds of skill set requirement. And my suggestion to whoever comes to me is you should use first 3 to 5 years in exploring. Now, there's a caveat to it that I still say that you should get at least a graduate degree in that time, because graduate degree also helps you get disciplined in your thought process and get disciplined in your building a foundation in at least one domain. So whether or not you're a specialist or a generalist, you must get a graduate degree or at least have the knowledge to that level, because it will build your one foundation, and that one foundation is required irrespective of your being a specialist or a generalist. And after exploring all the job options, all the market and your likability for it, that is when you would start shortlisting, okay, I like this kind of a work more, or the reverse is also true. This kind of a work likes me more, and therefore I should stick with this, or start narrowing from the exploratory phase to actually narrowing down from the, let's say, the 5 year career to the 10th year career. The next 5 years, you should try to focus as to, okay, this is the target that I'm hoping to achieve. And what necessarily determines a specialist or a generalist is your ability to stick to one topic. So there are some people who are able to, who don't necessarily get, let's say, intimidated by going deep into one topic. For those people, specialization is fine. But there are some people who say, like, I'll give you my example. I was okay with programming, but I didn't want to do programming as full time of my job. So that is the reason why I moved out from it and I started finding something that uses multiple domains and not just programming. But there are other people, like, again, Anirudh, he loves programming. that he just breathes in, breathes out that. So for someone like him, specialization is perfect. That he will excel at it, and he does excel at it. So that's what I would say, is that you should explore for first 2-3 years and also get a graduate degree, and then start figuring out what matches your personality more. It is not as much about the job market. It's most about what aligns most with who you are and what you want to be.
A very nice answer. Another question, which is, if the time permits, is if I'm looking towards you, your work and other thing, which do you find more challenging? The work which you've done from the business or finance point of view, or the work which you are doing on this earthquake prediction or the hurricane prediction, tornado and all those things, which is more challenging? Because the skills required are nearly the same, the risk prediction and all those things, but which is more challenging? Especially in business, finance also is more challenging. These are, obviously, I understand weather climate is continuously changing, but nowadays in LSE or Brexit or US presidential elections, every day something or the other is there, which changes our business finance approach. And yeah. So which is more challenging for you? Yes.
Yeah, so I would frame that as what I find more challenging, something that is not my core. So even though I work in a multidisciplinary field, there are some things that are more closer to my skill set than others. So for example, I'm not involved in the trading aspect of it. So for me, that is a challenge, because I need to understand more from the people who actually do it. So things that I don't do personally, I find it more challenging in terms of understanding. In terms of what I do myself, the image processing part, which is new to me, or which is something that I have learned on the job and I'm doing these days, that I find trickier, because I still have to learn and I'm still learning on the job. And handling these large data sets, these satellite images can get huge. And just working with these and setting up the systems and arrangements for these can be quite tricky, primarily because more and, as I was mentioning earlier in my talk as well, more and more companies are choosing to have fewer and fewer employees. And they are hoping to, what the companies do is they would get an outside consultant or an advisor to help you with one problem statement, but they're more and more relying on fewer in-house people. And therefore, you are necessarily up on yourself to do a lot of things. And for things that you are not necessarily good at, you have to kind of slug it out and fight it out and figure out how to do it.
Every coin has two sides. So what do you love and hate about your job?
So So the thing that I definitely like about my job is it always keeps me on my toes. That is, every day you go on the work, you are just dealing with five different things. You are talking, that is one of the aspects of the multidisciplinary, which I would highlight is there is a lot of, you have to switch between topics very quickly. You are working on something for 30 minutes, 45 minutes, and you are very deep, going deep into it. And suddenly you get a call and then you have to switch to a very different topic. And that has a switching cost. And it reducing that switching cost comes with a practice. But and that is something that I like, is that I get to do all kinds of different things as a part of my job. What I don't necessarily like about my job is that I would like my job to be more globally focused as opposed to only certain countries that have given out there these extreme climate and weather risks to private entities such as US or Europe or Japan. So countries like India, countries like Bangladesh, they have a massive need for these things because it's in my opinion, it's not sustainable enough for the government to continue using taxpayers' money or and not plan it ahead. And one of the big aspect of involving a lot of the private companies is that you get expertise that has been built over multiple years with different stakeholders. So, and if I don't find that happening, then I will have to move into a government domain going forward. That is something that I hope to do at least next 5-10 years, because we ourselves work with a lot of governments. We work with state governments of several countries. We work with central governments of several countries. We also work with World Bank. So we work with lot of these developing countries do not have sufficient funds to work with us. So what World Bank does is World Bank gets them in a room, 4 or 5 countries, and then helps us put it together. So and that is something that obviously is where things are going. And that I'll just finish my answer with adding additional point is that in the multidisciplinary part of the job, one part of my job is also learning how to interact with so many different stakeholders. So how you talk to a bank is very different from how you talk to a professor, is very different from how you talk to a government in Chile or Peru, or how you talk to a World Bank person. And that needs, and these are the kind of things that you have to learn or be ready to learn as part of your job.
A lot. Thanks, Mike.
Thank you, Professor Gupta. We have one more question. Devansh, if you can please mute. I think it's Professor Jaydeep Munetkar.
Hello, Mayank. It was a really great talk and really got to know the kind of things that you are working on and the kind of multidisciplinary nature of your job. And I was quite surprised the kind of different elements that you are using, right from finance to physics to computational to data science and statistics. So it's a really wonderful position that. My question is on the coursework that you did at DICT, particularly the technical coursework, because you talked about certain things like social sciences and courses of Aditi Nath that helped you. But as far as the technical courses, either the core courses or the elective courses, which were the ones that you really sort of enjoyed or played a part And also, how would you, if at all, would like to restructure the, you know, the technical electives, or is there any need to sort of restructure because now you have, you know, that experience to look back on those things? Yeah, that's my question.
Yeah, so one of the biggest takeaway for me from my undergrad was the ability to program. So because that is, as I've been saying, that irrespective of what industry you work in, you will be required to do at least some bit of, or have an informed understanding of how you're doing it. And same applies with statistics. So programming and statistics were something that I took back from my course, which continued me, and then you build it in your graduate schools. So that is definitely there. And on a general topic of the courses, doing an ICT kind of, it actually starts preparing you for a multidisciplinary from undergrad stage itself, because you are taking courses which are in electronics, particularly in the first 2 years. I'm assuming it's the same structure now, but in our time, we had electronics as well as we had to study the signal processing and computer science as well. So that you may not necessarily be good at all, just by the act of going through learning different topics which are so different from each other, it starts building your ability to do that. And that is the single most thing that I took back, is that your ability to learn different topics and your openness to do so. So you might learn it, but then if you're not open to doing it, you'll not be happy doing it. So, and in terms of structuring, course structuring, the one thing that I would definitely suggest is, and we have already talked about it with a lot of the professors, is that we should start involving some of the real life projects also in coursework. And these can be, they don't necessarily have that students have to do it. It's just that they have to be, if they are aware of this is the field or this is how it's exactly used in the industry now. So some alumni or someone from the industry, they come to the class, or they share with the students that what you are learning, this is exactly how this is used in industry. Because at times students learn a lot of things, but they are wondering, okay, where am I ever going to use this? So they just drop those topics that I don't ever think that I will ever use this. Now, same look at the field that I work in. I would have never thought that I would do physics later, or I would not do calculus later. But then those are a big part of my job. So, and these are the real life examples. If they are brought out, even though the students don't have the expertise to do that immediately, but just to see the relevance in the real world, it's a big incentive for the students to focus.
All right. Thank you for your answer.
Thank you, man, sir. I guess Lee, I have one general question from the student community at large, especially focusing on DIICT. If you might be aware that these days the general culture around placements, and especially at DIICT, is what we call competitive coding and doing that to get into product-based companies. So yeah, Almost our entire batch is largely focused on that. And you know, this sometimes means that we are losing out on our core knowledge, especially like you said, multi-domain knowledge is something that we are missing out on. So what might your advice be to students, you know, who are focusing largely on CP? Is that a good enough approach for the long run, or would you suggest some change?
So as I mentioned earlier, that you have to have some foundation on which you have to build your career, either in generalist domain or specialist domain. So if you have chosen that particular field that you're talking about, the competitive coding, if that is your foundation that you have to build, that's fine. But then I would suggest is do some coursework or have some learning in fields that are as far away from that field. And the objective of that, and the primary objective of that, is so that your brain is trained enough to absorb topics and things that are away from what you are completely focused on. Because unless you do that, what's going to happen is it's part of your evolution. That if you're not training yourself or preparing yourself for it, if you try doing it 5 years later, 10 years later, as you grow older, your ability to learn shrinks, and you can ask almost anyone that. And for that, you have to keep that machine, that learning machine in yourself, constantly oiled. And if you are spending 80% of time doing one thing, try to do it 20% of time in something that is as far away from that one thing, and with objective of not necessarily learning that, but to be able to learn those things as quickly as you can, whenever asked. So that is my suggestion on that topic. And if you want to know more about it, you should definitely talk to Anirudh in the next session.
Perfect. Yeah, thanks. Kanupriya, man, if you're there.
Can I have a small query from Mayank?
Yeah.
Yeah, Mayank, thank you very much for such a scintillating topic. In fact, I was able to relate myself with the topic, you know. So some of these things I have been teaching for last 3 years to second year BTech students as a part of environment studies.
Okay.
La Nina, El Nina, how it affects the Indian monsoon thing particularly. Because that happens in the Pacific region, so east and west coast gets affected. You know?
Yeah.
So these are some of the things I have been teaching, trying to tell the students. I'm not sure students are happy or not, but the third or fourth year students are there. They have attended my course. Generally, they are not happy. I know about it. Okay. The second thing is that because you talked about the insurance, you know, the recently you have also worked in an insurance, crop insurance, not the property insurance, the life insurance. The crop insurance you have worked with the government of Gujarat using large scale satellite data, you know. And as a part of that thing, we have done a lot of data analysis, crop classification, crop condition assessment. And then we have given this results to the government, and the farmers were compensated of the order of 800 crores, 800 crores in the government districts. So, you know, that, so it is coming up, but not so fast as it is expected. You know, the supply chain, its utility for a different kind of applications, I think it's coming up very fast. I want to know only one thing from you, because you have talked about the satellite data. Are you using some microbe data or only using the optical data?
No. We use the multispectral.
Oh.
Because
microwave data is different. They say working on a
microwave data. No. I was saying that we use spectral, various spectral layers.
Okay. Which data set you are using? Planet data set or
no.
Sentinel data set?
Yes. So in terms of the satellite imagery, we rely on a lot of Landsat data. So Landsat is a US-based, Sentinel is a Europe focus. So we use a lot of the Landsat data. Landsat has several kinds of data. One of them is the analysis ready data, ARD data set. So Landsat ARD is very easy to use. And even the US government has prepared a lot of Python notebooks for you to be able to do a lot of the analysis quite efficiently. So that is one thing that we are working on, a kind of a more of a macro level. But if we want to work on a more detailed or higher resolution imagery, we source these satellite imageries from companies such as Maxar, so Digital Globe. So they have much finer resolution. Obviously, we have to pay for it. So we necessarily use these multispectral data, not the radio frequency ones.
Yeah, but
we definitely
data is basically, you know, to be used in those areas, particularly in our Kharif season when you are working, because microwave data is transferring to the cloud.
Microwave
data is not transferring to the cloud.
Yes.
You can see the surface, you know.
Yeah.
So that's the reason I was thinking you are giving examples of the optical data, but whether you are using any microwave data or not. Because this is completely different.
Yeah. So as an example, in terms of the land management, we look at something known as we look at this, the before and after can be done using the NDVIs. So how the land has changed after a fire and after an event. So these help us capture a lot of those, and that we, our primary source is the analysis ready data from Landsat for those things.
That's fine. Thank you very much. I'm sure that your talk will really enthuse the students, the utility of the satellite data and for many kind of applications.
Yeah, and I'm more than happy to talk more in detail with your class and your students.
Actually, the assignments I am giving is basically that kind of a satellite data evolution before and after an event for different type of, not only on land but also on ocean.
Yeah.
The productivity in the ocean changes, you know.
Yes.
Because that invites this fish to come there and how so the changes.
Yeah, so there are financial products that are based off of the oxygen content offshore back the fisheries. So you can have financial products that that absorb the shock against any material movement in oxygen content in the oceans. So for that, people do all kinds of analysis as well.
Thank you. I hope we can enthusiasm the students to attend the classes at least in environment. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. We have one question from Milan, who is a BTech fourth year student. He wanted to gain some insights from you for doing MBA outside India, and like what sort of colleges and what sort of criteria should we look into for, especially specific to MBA.
Okay, so my answer to that and similar questions is that you have to first understand why you want to do what you want to do, and I'm happy to talk about it, but I would like to know, why are you wanting to do an MBA and what do you hope to gain out of it? And that determines A, is it the right thing for you to do, and B, when should you do it, and C, where should you do it from? So the question is quite generic, so it's difficult for me to answer, but and that's true for most of the graduate programs, that you have to understand why you are wanting to do it and what you hope to get out of it. So the subsequent point to that is, we have talked with our faculty as well as Professor Das Gupta that I and some of us are hoping to take out a couple of hours, 3 hours, 4 hours a month to talk to the students. So we'll have to figure out the logistics of that, how do we put in place, but something like 2 hours per week, 3 hours per month on the weekend, I'm happy to talk to you about topics, all kinds of topics.
Cool. Kanupriya, ma'am, I don't think you are audible. If you could just speak out. Devanshu, if you could please check if Kanupriya, ma'am, is audible or not.
She is unmuted.
Looks like she's on a phone. Through a phone, connected through phone?
Yes, she is. Ma'am, maybe you could write the question in the chat and I'll just ask her right here, since I don't think you're able to speak. Yeah. So Kanupriya ma'am asks, would be one piece of advice you'd like to give to students who will be taking a leap in these times of the global pandemic? Like any ideas or advice specific to the present situation that we are facing? Anything that you'd like to share?
Okay. I think there are more senior people to advise you on such things, but I will give you my opinion on it. My opinion on it is that you should prepare yourself to face these issues more often. If you think this is bad, my belief is things are not going to be better for quite some time. And that requires you to have kind of a, it's about how you mentally prepare yourself. It's not as much about what you study or what jobs you do. It's about how you mentally prepare yourself to be as productive as you can in whatever field you end up going into. And because what's going to happen is, given the current market and economy, it's not a job seeker's market. So you won't get what you necessarily want. So you will have to take whatever you get. And in that, you have to excel, no matter whether you like it or not like it. And then you learn whatever is required to excel in where you are. And then when the situation improves, see how you can switch to something that you would like to rather do than what you have been forced to do.
All right. Thank you so much, sir. I guess that brings us to the end of the questions we have. If sir doesn't mind, we'll also share his LinkedIn link along in the chat so that if there are any more questions from the students, you can take it up with him over LinkedIn directly, and he'll be interacting with us on and off again.
Yeah.
Sure. So that brings us to the end of the session. I would like to first of all thank our director, Professor K.S. Dasgupta, for bringing forth this initiative. We have all seen how productive it was for the students, all of us, to find out all this stuff that we might never have known otherwise. So a big thanks to Professor K.S. Dasgupta. Many thanks to Professor Ghosh for always helping us out. Also like to thank the professors who interacted, Professor Mitra, Professor Gupta, Professor Mulayarkar. So big thanks. Again, thanks to all of the attendees who took the time out to help us, make this event a success. And of course, the biggest thanks to Mayank Mishra sir, who in spite of his busy schedule, took the time out and is so willing to help us have better path forward in our career. So I'll just share the link to his LinkedIn profile, Mayank sir's LinkedIn, in the chat itself. So that any questions that you might have, you can take it up with him directly.
Mayank, thank you now. All the best, and I look forward to have your closer interaction with you. Okay?
Thank you, Mayank. I don't want to say formally thank you, because I believe we continue to now, it's only the beginning. We'll continue to interact in future also.
Yes, we will.
I'm looking for you for some another interaction sometime, maybe on phone or something, whenever you are convenient for you.
Yes.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
All right. Okay. Thank you, all of you. Have a good day.
Bye-bye.